Good morning and welcome to this week's Sunday service. Let us step into a time of worship. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for bringing each and every one of us here into your presence. We thank you for your grace and guidance, Lord. It is only by your will that we are here, Father. And Lord, we know that you will raise up praises from even the stones, Lord Jesus, if we do not worship you. But you have given us the heart and the will to worship you, Father. And today, as we are gathered here, Lord Jesus, in our homes and in this church, Lord Jesus, we pray that it will be a time of praise and glorification for your name, Lord Jesus. It's not for us, it's not for the church, Lord Jesus, but it's only for you, Lord Jesus. Help us to focus on you and to place our hearts and our minds in front of you, Lord Jesus, at your altar, Lord. Let our praise and our songs be a pleasing sacrifice to you, Lord Jesus. We ask this in your precious name.
Amen.
Every time we come into God's presence, he welcomes us with open arms. All he's asking from us is that we come with a willing heart, that we come here to enjoy his presence, that we want to revel in the grace and glory that he bestows upon us. He's been so merciful to us in the last few months where everything has been so uncertain. And at this time, on this Sunday morning, let us tell him, Lord, we are here to worship you. We do not want anything but to be in your presence. Let us meditate on his word with no distractions. Let us set our heart and mind upon him. As we sing this first song, Here I Am to Worship, let us close our eyes and meditate on his word and tell him that, Lord, we are here. All we want to do is sing praises to you, and we want to do this for you in eternity. Let us sing together.
Together.
Yes, Lord, you are the light of this world, and without you we have nothing. We can't see the path ahead without you, Lord. And when God shows us the way, all we have to do is blindly follow him, because he has nothing but the best for us. He has so many plans which are beyond our understanding. And when life gets difficult, when things around us seem so bleak, all we have to do is cry on his name. Our God is the God of love, of mercy, of grace. He is the one who has us in his mind. He's engraved us on the palms of his hand. That is how mindful he is of us. He does not forget us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. With that promise, all we have to do is go to him and tell him, Lord, when you are with me, who can stand against me? No spear formed against you in this world can prosper, because God is on your side, God is on our side. And that's all the assurance that we need. Let us sing the next song together, Our God.
Our God is healer.
The darkness of the world, God shines His light upon us. He guides the way for us. And it's a path that we are called to follow as Christians. It's not an easy path. It is not the most popular path, but we are called to walk it. And it might seem like we are walking this path alone, that we have been called to carry our cross and follow Him all alone with our own strength. But God has given us the gift of His Holy Spirit. He has provided for us the strength to follow Him in this world that is filled with so many distractions, with so many ways that we can fall by the wayside. Let us renew our commitment today to walking with God, because He never lets us walk alone. He is always by our side. Let us recommit ourselves to Christ today. I have decided to follow Jesus, and there is no turning back. Join us in singing this song and committing ourselves back to Christ. Time that we have been given to reconnect with God, to sing His praises, to learn more and more about Him. And in this time of worship, we've learned so much about God, that He is our healer, He is our protector, He is the light of this world, He is our personal Savior. As we enter this week, let us continue to sing His praises every moment. Let us have a constant conscious communion with Him at every point of our lives, every second of every day. Let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank You, Lord, for giving us the privilege that it is to worship You, to know You, to have You as our Savior, Lord Jesus. We pray, Lord, that our praises and our worship will rise up to You, Lord Jesus, in heaven, that you will be pleased with us, Lord Jesus, that you will accept our praise and our prayers, Lord. We pray that as we enter this week, that you will lead the way for us, Lord Jesus. We have decided to follow you. There is no turning back from you, Lord Jesus. Help us to walk the narrow path led by your light. Father, we pray that you will continue to be with us as we go into this service time, Lord Jesus, that you will speak to us through the prayers and through the sermon, and that you will help us to be refreshed to start a new week. We ask this in your precious name. Amen.
The name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, I greet you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I welcome all of you to join in the worship service that is being conducted this morning. May the Lord Almighty meet us all through this worship service and speak to us through His words and inspire us that we may offer Him a meaningful worship service this morning. May we all bow heads in prayer. Thank you, dear Father, for giving us this wonderful opportunity to gather together as your children in this holy sanctuary to worship you this morning. We look back and see the wonderful ways by which you have been guiding us and leading us and bringing us thus far. We thank you, Lord, from the bottom of our hearts for all the good things that you have been doing in our lives. For your care, for your protection, for your provision, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your continued protection that you have granted unto us. We thank you for keeping us under the wings of your protection and saving us from the dangers and trials of this world. Lord, we pray that as we begin the worship service this morning, we pray that your presence shall be granted unto us, and also you will fill our hearts with your presence so that we may participate in this worship service with joy and gladness. Be with us from the beginning of the service till its end. Let your holy name be glorified. In Jesus' matchless and wonderful name, we say this prayer. Amen. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before Lord our God. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. O that today you would listen to his voice. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false, and do not swear deceitfully. To the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him, and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by following his laws, which he set before us by his servants, the prophets. The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Jesus said, come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. I will get up and go to my Father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. Altogether, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Amen. Almighty and gracious God, in whom alone our hearts find rest and peace, we ask you to reveal yourself to us in this hour of worship. Pour down upon us your spiritual gifts and grant that this season of holy quiet may be profitable to us in heavenly things, and refresh and strengthen us to finish the work which you have given us to do. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is the steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. Let us confess our sins in silence. The general confession. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy. Blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin, for I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you alone have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Amen. Grant, we ask you, merciful Lord, to your faithful people pardon and peace, that they may be cleansed from all their sins and serve you with a quiet mind through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. The scripture portion for us this morning is taken from the book of Acts chapter 6 verses 1 to 6. Acts chapter 6 verse 1 to 6. Now in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. And the 12 summoned the full member of the disciples and said, "It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." And what they said pleased the whole gathering, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit, and Philip and Prochorus and Nicanor and Timon and Parmenas and Nicolaus, a proselyte of Antioch. These they set before the apostles, and they prayed and laid their hands on them. And the word of God continued to increase, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. Here ends the reading of the scriptural portion. Thanks be to you, O God. Now may we all join in singing the hymn, "Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven." Praise my soul, the King of Heaven. Thank you. may we bow our heads in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that you have granted us to listen to your word, to digest them, and to put them into practice in our own lives, so that our life may get transformed through your words, and we may lead a new life. Thank you, Lord, for granting us this wonderful time when we are called to divert our attention, shift our attentions on world and worldly things, and fix our attention on you, dear Master, so that we may receive every word that comes out of the Word of God from the Bible, so that we may get nourished and get strengthened in our spiritual life, Master. Be with us and bless us all. In Jesus' matchless and wonderful name, we say this prayer. Amen. Friends, the topic that has been given to us by the diocese is conflicts and peace, conflicts and peace. I think it is a more relevant theme that we are called to discuss upon this morning, because we hear about the news about the impending war, the divisions, the conflicts between communities, conflicts between nations, which threaten the very existence of the humanity. The word peace is spoken very often in Christian circles. The word peace comes from the Hebrew word shalom, and the connotation is positive. The word is very much positive in nature. When someone says shalom or peace unto you, it does not mean that I hope you will not get into any trouble. It doesn't mean so. So it is a positive term. Many consider peace as absence of trouble. Peace, absence of trouble. It is not so. The biblical teaching of peace is something which is unrelated to whatever happens to us or around us. Something which is unrelated to the circumstances that we are placed in. One may be in the midst of trials and still have peace. Paul said he could be content in any circumstances. That is a wonderful experience. You know, in the book of Acts, you will see that he was put in jail. Acts chapter 16, you get the information from this particular chapter. Though he was put in the jail behind bars, yet he was able to sing songs and rejoice in the Lord. Apostle James wrote in James chapter 1 verse 16, James chapter 1 verse 2, he said, "Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials." The most definite discourse on peace could be found, you know, from all these pages of the scripture, the most definite, you know, saying on peace could be found from the words that Jesus uttered to his disciples. Before his crucifixion, Jesus knew what he was about to face. The irony of the situation is that it was precisely in that difficult, grim moment Jesus preached or taught peace to his disciples. John's Gospel chapter 4 verse 27, he said, "Peace I leave you, I leave with you. My peace I give you. Not as the world gives you, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, nor let it be fearful." So this was said when Jesus knew that he was going to, you know, face trial and he will be put into death. That was the time he says, "Peace I leave with you." my peace I give you. So peace, according to biblical understanding, is no way connected to the circumstances that we are found in. There are four things that I want to share with you based on this theme. The first one is priority of peace. The priority of peace. There can be no doubt that as Christians, we are called to receive or experience and enjoy peace in our own lives. And also, we are called to be peacemakers. First, we receive God's peace, the peace in our own lives. Then, after having experienced peace in our own lives, we are called to be peacemakers wherever we live. Romans chapter 12 verse 18 says, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all people. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all people. Verse 19, Romans 12, 19, never avenge yourself, but leave it to the wrath of God. And also we see in Matthew's Gospel chapter 5, verse 9, Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, because they will be called the children of God. So peace is very important in our lives, in our personal lives, and also in our social and communal, in the community life. And we see, the Bible talks about the origin of conflict, origin of war, origin of disagreement, you see. Epistle of Apostle James, chapter 4, verse 1, he says, what causes quarrels and what causes fights among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war with you? So, James the Apostle finds the reason for conflicts or disagreements or battles and warfare that we witness in our today's life. What causes quarrels and what causes fights among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war with you? Verse 2, you desire and do not have. So you murder, you covet and you cannot obtain. So you fight and quarrel. So the reason that James pointing out is that we desire, we covet, and when we don't get what we desire or what we covet, we get into quarrel or we get into fight. And this is the reason for conflicts in our lives or conflicts in the society. You know, covet and desire for more than what you have. Already God has blessed us, but to covet more than what we have is something wrong according to the Bible. It is a sin according to the Bible. You know, covetousness and having more desire, unsatisfied desire, will lead us to selfishness, a sense of selfishness, passion for what we don't have. You know, a general who having defeated his last enemy, wept at the thought of having no more conquests. So this is a common weakness. We covet, we desire for what we need not have. We already have, but we want still more. This is the reason for the conflicts or the disagreements or battles that we witness in our lives, in our families, in the church, and in the wider society. So disagreements in family leads to disputes. Many families suffer under this problem. Disagreement between the members of the family, that leads them into disputes. And disputes lead them to enmity and estrangement. And enmity leads to quarrels and fight. And this is the common order that we find in the families today. In the church also, again, we come across instances where people disagree with one another and people fight with one another, quarrel with one another. And selfishness, as James very rightly says, covetousness or selfishness is the reason for this problem. And some of us want to enjoy more popularity, and some of us underestimate others. And therefore, disagreements between the members, disputes against between the members and quarrels between the members are a common experience in the present day church. When we are to fight against those who oppose the gospel, there is a need for us to fight. We need to stand against those who oppose the gospel, those who are up to pull down the churches. But unfortunately, we are fighting within ourselves. We are fighting among ourselves. So this is the problem with the present day family and present day church and present day community. The covetousness, the desire, selfishness is the reason for experiencing conflict in our family life and in our church, in the society. The second point I would like to make is that there is a need for peace. You know, we must have peace. The conflicts and disagreements always disturb the peace, and therefore we must have the peace. Peace is the only alternate to the conflicts or the disagreements or the quarrels between us. And we need peace because our families are broken, lacking in peace. Somebody has said that man is a moving volcano. You know, it is boiling underneath, but outwardly nothing is seen. Somebody has said man is a moving volcano. He may appear to be fine outwardly, but inwardly he is boiling, he is restless, he has lost his peace. There are so many people we can find facing this problem in their personal lives. Anxieties and worries make a person to lose his peace. And also, peace is necessary for our families too. Broken families. Families are primarily built on relationship between one another, members of the family. But families suffer for the reason that there is no peace in the family. So we need peace in our families. Peace is the only solution for the conflicts that we face in the families. Broken families, families that quarrel on many issues, petty issues, families that quarrel on properties, families that quarrel on personal reasons, and the church, our families need peace very much. Church is called a larger family in which we are called to share our love for one another. Therefore, the church, because of the conflicts, the church has lost its peace. Therefore, peace is necessary, very much necessary, in the church life too. The community is very much broken, fragmented, divided on the basis of language, caste, and creed, faith. You see, we hear much about one community fighting against the other community, someone killing others on the basis of the faith one holds. And therefore, the person as an individual very much needs peace, families need peace, and the community need peace, the congregation need peace. So necessity, there is a strong necessity for peace. The humanity is facing unprecedented global problems. There are so many problems that disturb the peace of the people. Poverty, human trafficking, nuclear weapons, climate change, migrant labor issues, border disputes between nations. Right now, our country is involved in discussion with China on border issue. The discussion is prolonging, not coming to an end, not able to find a permanent solution. Broken family relations, divorces on the rise, Christian families standing in the legal court, challenging each other, one another, terrorism, indiscriminate killing of innocent people. So these are the issues that the humanity faces today. Therefore, peace is lost. Peace cannot be found, is not to be found in the life of the society and community. So if so, what is the solution? Some of us may say that wars or battles could be one permanent, could bring a permanent solution to this problem of conflict. But our experience says that the battles or wars have compounded the problem more and more in the past years. Look at the Bible. In Bible also, you find instances where people quarreled with each other. There was conflict between communities, between kingdoms. For example, if you read the book of Joshua, the book of Joshua is full of narration about wars and battles. Battle to own the land, battle to protect the land, to preserve the land. But also, the Bible also talks about instances where people, with the help of God, guided by the Spirit of God, avoided conflicts in their lives. For example, in the book of Genesis chapter 13, we see there was likely a conflict between Abraham and his niece and his nephew, Lot. You know, which portion they have to choose. Abraham, being the elder and senior, had the legitimate right to choose the best part of the land. If you go through the Genesis chapter 13, you see Abraham telling Lot, saying, "You choose whatever you want, and I will have whatever is left after you have chosen your portion." This also we find in the Bible. And also we come across instances where Isaac used to dig up wells in the promised land. And when these wells were seized and the wells were filled with sand again, mud again, we find Jacob not preferring to fight against them, but quietly move to other place, avoiding any conflicts with the people. And 2 Kings chapter 6, we see there was a king from the land of Aramea invading Israel. And Elisha stepped in and advised the king of Israel to treat them properly, to treat the enemies, to arrange a dinner for them, to provide them with food and water. And that was a suggestion given to the king by Elisha, which we find in 2 Kings chapter 6. The result was that the word of God says in 2 Kings chapter 6, 23, that the people, the army of Aramea, the Aramean king, he dropped the idea of invading Israel anymore. The hostility came to an end permanently. And therefore, peace, you know, there is a necessity for peace, and we have to experience in our own lives. We have to enable others also to experience peace in their lives, at any cost. What are the means of peace? What are the means of peace? You know, look at the present world. This is something vastly different from what it used to be before. Now the technological advancements have placed the humanity in such a way that we are more interconnected globally. We are close to each other. We can make friends with people all over the world. Making friends or enemies is the best strategy. Making friends of enemies is the best strategy to counter hatred and enmity. Make friends out of enemy. Peacemaking means we find ways to turn the enemy to friend. This is the best strategy that we can adopt. So when we consider the fact that what are the means of experiencing peace in our personal lives, what are the means for enabling others also to experience peace in their lives, making friends out of enemies. The Word of God says, love one another. That is the basic principle. Love one another. Even if the other person hates you, love him, love her, love one another. And bear each other's burdens. This is another wonderful suggestion that comes out of the Bible. Bear each other's burdens. Galatians chapter 6 verse 2. Bear one another's burdens and so fulfill law of Christ. And the third suggestion comes out of the Bible is, do not repay evil for evil. These are the means by which we can establish peace in the community. You can establish peace in our families. Love one another, bear each other's burdens, do not repay evil for evil. Romans chapter 12 verse 17 says, repay no one evil for evil. So these are the means by which we can still experience peace in our lives. We can help others also to experience peace in their lives, in the community. The fourth fact that I want to stress now is the source of peace. You know, there are two ways by which, you know, we can experience peace. The world readily offers peace. This is one way of experiencing peace in our lives. But this is not the right way. The world offers peace. John's Gospel, chapter 14, verse 27. Peace I give you, Jesus said. Peace I give you, not as the world gives, do I give you. Here, Jesus makes a clear distinction between the peace that he was offering and the peace that the world was offering. The peace that the world gives is only temporary. You know, the world's way of offering peace is through opium, alcohol, drugs, and other forms of escapism. Through these, you do not get a permanent peace. This will not give you a permanent solution. This is the world's way of offering peace. Jesus said, I give you peace, my peace I give you, not as the world gives do I give you. You see, the Bible, God is called using, you know, several terminologies. God of might, almighty, God of power, and so on and so on. And there is very important fact that is ascribed to this God, is God of peace, God of peace. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 verse 16. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 23. So many references say that this God, the Lord we worship, whom we worship, is God of peace. So he is the source of peace. Though though the world may claim that it is the source of peace, it is not true. It is God who is the source of peace. My peace I give you. Notice the word my peace. It is Christ's own personal peace. You know, the same deep, rich, supernatural peace that stilled his heart in the midst of mockery, hatred, traitors, and murderers. Every one of them he faced. You see, when did he say this? My peace I give you. That was towards the end of his ministry, when he was about to be crucified. That was the occasion he was telling his disciples that, my peace I give you. He knew pretty well that he will be mocked, he will be hated, and he will be betrayed, and finally he will be murdered. But he said, but in spite of all these experiences that I will be facing, my peace that goes beyond all these will be yours. My peace I give you. When Christ appeared before Pilate, we see this incident from the Gospels. He was cool and composed. He was calm and he was serene, at peace. And Pilate, looking at him, became greatly disturbed. And he was furious that Jesus was standing before him, fearless. In near frenzy, Pilate said, don't you know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you? So such was the peace that Jesus enjoyed in his personal life. And that peace he offered to his people, to his disciples, and even to us who are followers of Jesus. And Jesus is the source of peace. He said he will give that peace freely to all of us. So let us turn towards him and receive his gift of peace in our personal lives. And the result of the final point that I would like to make is the result of peace. The promise of Jesus was that I give you my peace. And the result, the promise that went along with that was that I'll give you my peace. Do not let your heart be troubled, nor let it be fearful. These promises go together. I give my peace to you, and do not let your hearts be troubled, nor let it be fearful. If you look around and see the things that are happening around us, naturally we get disturbed. We lose our peace, and we become fearful, and we become more anxious. The word of God, Jesus says, I'll give you my peace. With the peace that I will be giving you as a gift, you will be able to overcome the fear and anxiety that you face in your day-to-day life. The peace of God protects us from the feelings of fear. Peace of God helps us to sail through the troubles that we face in our lives. I would like to conclude the sermon with a note that the result of peace is very obvious for us to understand, for us to grasp. The first thing is that it is continuous peace. The peace that the world offers is not permanent. It is only temporary. Alcohol, opium, drugs, any of this will not give a person permanent peace or permanent relief from the worries and tensions that he may carry in his heart. But the peace that comes from the Lord is permanent. It is continuous. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 verse 16. Now may the Lord of peace himself continually grant you peace. Look at this word. Paul was wishing the members of the church at Thessalonica, saying that may the peace of God continually be with you. And it is the second thing I want to share, I want to stress, is it is not only continuous, it is complete. Colossians chapter 3 verse 15. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Again, look at this particular verse. Look at the use, look at the word that Paul uses here. Let the peace of Christ rule over hearts. Take complete control over you, not leaving any aspect of your life. May you experience God's peace in every aspect of your life, the completeness of God's peace. This is the result when we receive God's peace in our personal lives. And also, the third thing, we become peacemakers. I mentioned we receive God's peace which is continuous. We receive God's peace which is complete. And the third fact is that we become peacemakers. Having received the peace of God in our lives, we become in turn peacemakers. You know, there are conflicts in families, there are conflicts in societies, in communities. We as God's children, we step in and try to resolve the conflicts that exist between individuals, between families, between the communities. You know, we become peacemakers when we receive the peace of God in our lives. When we are filled with the peace of God in our lives, then it is easy for us to become peacemakers in the society, in the community. So this is the result of receiving God's, of experiencing God's peace in our own lives. So I would like to just remind you about the facts that I mentioned during the course of this sermon. The first one is priority of peace. The second point was the necessity of peace. The third point was the source of peace. The fourth point, the means of peace. And the fifth point is the result of peace. So peace is such a wonderful gift. And God has offered this wonderful gift to each and every one of us. If only we have faith on Him, we immediately receive this gift in our own lives and enjoy peace, even in the midst of trials and hardships that we face. And we in turn become God's agents and God's instruments in helping people to resolve the conflicts that exist between them. May the Lord Almighty continue to speak to us and help us to understand the calling with which He has called us. We are called to be the peacemakers, because the word of God says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Amen. Now, having heard the word of God, let us profess our faith on the Lord through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Friends, on your behalf, I would like to thank Mr. George Theodore and his family for donating 6 LED smart TVs to the church. As this worship service is conducted as per the guidelines of the government, in which we are called to maintain social distancing and other regulations, there was a need for smart LED TVs, and therefore this family has come forward to help us in this matter. And these LED TVs will be mounted on the pillars and will be used to display the scriptural portion text and other content relevant to our church worship service. I once again thank this loving family for coming forward to meet the need of the church. May God bless this family abundantly. Let us pray. Lord, we thank You, and we thank You for Your word, and we thank You, Lord, for this loving family which has donated generously to meet the important need of the church. We pray that you will stretch forth the blessing arms and bless this family and bless bless that gift, the LED TVs, that these LED TVs may serve the church for a long time and may be a source of great blessing for those who enter into this church to worship you, dear Master. Lord, we pray for the peace in this world, peace in our families, peace in our personal lives. God, who is author of peace and lover of concord, in whose knowledge our eternal life stands, whose service is perfect freedom, defend us, your humble servants, from all assaults of evil, that we, surely trusting in your defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let's pray for the grace of God. O Lord, our refuge, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with your mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings may be ordered by your governance to do always that which is righteous in your sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you most humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your boundless love in the redemption of the world by your Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we ask you to give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Redeemer, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications to you, and does promise that when two or three are gathered together in your name, you will grant the requests, fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of your servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the world to come life everlasting. Amen. Unto God's most gracious mercy and protection, we commit all of you this moment. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us all, now and forevermore. Now may we all sing together the hymn Onward Christian Soldiers. Onward Christian Soldiers. Thank you. The Lord be with you. Let us depart in peace. In the name of the Lord. Amen.